Good evening. Welcome to the University of New England Center for Global Humanities. My name is Josh Pagan, and I'm filling in tonight for my friend Anouar Majid, who many of you know. Anouar is on our beautiful campus in Tangier, Morocco tonight, no doubt watching the live stream. Anouar, even though you're not here, we're thinking of you, and we feel your spirit in the lecture hall, although your presence is certainly missed. We hope all is going well overseas. Tonight we have the pleasure of welcoming William Phillips Jr. and Carla Rahn Phillips, professors emeriti from the University of Minnesota, who have published and lectured extensively on Spain's history, culture, and global influence. Together, they are the co-authors of A Concise History of Spain, which was published in 2010 by Cambridge University Press. Between them, they have authored dozens of publications that have enriched our knowledge of this country that is an important link between Europe and the Islamic world, as well as Europe and Latin America. Truly, Spanish influence extends to nearly all corners of the globe, and tonight we have the chance to learn more about this fascinating country. I believe Carla will speak first, and then William will take a turn at the podium, and we'll go from there. So please join me in welcoming William and Carla Phillips.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here, not the least because we can actually use our winter coats from Minnesota again. We now live in Central Texas, and there are not that many opportunities to use our winter gear. This is the kind of night that Minnesotans would call not quite yet brisk. It's too warm to be brisk, but it's cold enough for me these days. You have come to hear a lecture on Spain and the world, 3,000 years of history. That's actually not quite accurate. If we go back to prehistoric times, which we will do, it's actually 800,000 years of history, prehistory and history. You can trace humankind in the Iberian Peninsula back that far. When we set out to write this book, and actually Cambridge University Press invited us to write it, the trick was, how much do we do? So many concise histories really will start with the 19th century and the 20th, assuming that no one really cares about anything earlier. But you can't understand, I think, any history, but you certainly can't understand the history of Spain without going way, way back to the geoforms in the Iberian Peninsula, to the earliest inhabitants, to everything that shaped the people and their history in that part of the world. So we told Cambridge that we really wanted to do the whole thing, and we would give equal weight to the centuries that came way before the 19th and 20th, and we would certainly cover those, but they wouldn't be the main focus of our book. So that we can assume that a few of you have read our concise history, many of you have not. We'll be showing you a lot of pictures of the history of Spain, and we'll try to cover some of the main issues and themes that we thought were important to cover in the book. But there's no way we can gallop through 800,000 years of history in 60 minutes and do justice to the richness of that history. Some of the main themes, however, that we focused on, and they'll come up in this lecture, I've already mentioned one of them, the very, very difficult ecology of the Iberian Peninsula. We have a variety of climatic zones in this country. Spain has every one of the kinds of zones that we have in a much smaller compass. And in addition, they have some subtropical areas that you're sort of hard-pressed to find in the continental US. So very varied ecology. And then varied peoples, waves of humanity coming in and out over the millennia, all of whom shaped the culture, the language, the way that cities looked, all kinds of things were a product of this diversity of people who came to the peninsula. And the peninsula itself, located in a strategic part of the world, would come to form a bridge between the Europe of the Eastern Hemisphere, the Americas of the Western Hemisphere, which indeed they, the Spaniards first realized were there, and also a bridge between Europe on the north and Africa on the south. So Spain became a crossroads of humanity, crossroads of culture, but also by definition had to deal with cultures all around their own region and eventually all around the world. Spain was really the first global empire. Spanish culture, as I've said, everything had to do with this diversity of people. Another set of themes, the importance of religion, both good and bad, and the importance of religion as a meeting ground, not only among Christians, and we think of Spain as a quintessentially Christian culture, but as a meeting ground for Jews and Muslims, as well as Christians. And indeed, the medieval centuries that my husband will talk about were marked by what's called convivencia, living together, not necessarily liking one another all the time, but living together. Really a unique experience for Europe. And then the Spanish Empire, when it developed in the Americas, formed yet another part of the world that Spaniards learned to deal with and left their mark on for all time, really. Okay, so if we look at how we got from the present, where we are now, or where we were when we wrote this book, and try to get back to the past of Spain. Many of you know how historians work. Some of you maybe don't. Your lecture guests in this series are not all historians, and in fact, we may be the only historians this year. But historians, when they're doing original work, go back to the original sources in the past, either handwritten or published when publication became possible. Way back, epigraphy, archaeology, numismatics, architecture, art, literature, and when you get into later centuries, historians look at government documents, private documents, correspondence. And when you get into the modern centuries, of course, we have film, we have periodical literature, newspapers, we have magazines. All of those things are primary sources that historians use. Then there are one step away from those original things are translated, edited, or interpreted sources, both handwritten and published. And translated, well, you have to figure out, can you trust those translations? Can you do it yourself? Can you trust yourself when you do those translations? You're one step removed from what we might consider the authentic sources. But nonetheless, you use them because you have to. And historians publish scholarly articles and monographs, and we have done our share of that. And when you publish a monograph or a scholarly article, you've really dived into the primary sources. You know what you're talking about. Or at least you should, or you shouldn't publish. But you can have a nice, firm sense of that. When you get to a synthesis, and we won't even talk about textbooks, that's way off the scale here. When you get to a synthesis, you are trying to bring together the work of all kinds of other scholars. Your own work, yes, but scholars who work in fields that you might know very, very little about, and you simply have to figure out ways to trust them or to evaluate those sources. I do that with underwater archaeology all the time, which is important to my own work, but I don't do it myself. I simply have to know whom to trust. So the government documents that we have both used for the history of Spain are in Spanish state archives. You can't read this very well, but you can see all the various archival districts. The historical archives in Spain, something like 152 million linear meters, not of documents laid edge to edge, but bundles stacked next to one another. So lots, in other words. And administrative archives, another 150 million linear meters. We haven't read them all, but they're out there, and they are fairly well taken care of. For the centuries between about 1500 and 1800, the archive of Simancas in the province of Valladolid are housed in this wonderful old castle. You go through that door, one of my very favorite places on earth. The Archive of the Indies, as it's called in Seville, is here. It's the old merchant building, the old merchant Lonja, next to the cathedral in downtown Seville. And we go to these places to find documents. But when you're writing a synthesis, can you go to the original sources and leap directly to the synthesis? Only if you have 1,000 lifetimes to know all of the fields and all of the documents that you need to know to write a proper synthesis. So instead, you use original sources for the fields that you specialize in, but then you make the great leap of faith and trust to deal with sources that somebody else has found and edited, maybe translated. You use scholarly articles and monographs of your own, but also of other people, and learn who the best scholars are who are working in the fields that you need to fill in. So it's a kind of trade-off. A lot of it is trust, and then you end up with a synthesis that you hope represents the best of scholarship that is out there. You can't always be right, and you might trust somebody who ends up being a dingbat, who really didn't do proper archival research of his or her own. It's always a risk. But if you know the field and you know the people in the field, you do get to the point where you know whom you can trust. So in coming up with a concise history of Spain, we did all of these things to come up with a synthesis that seemed to us to represent this very, very broad and diverse history of a country that hasn't been around as a country for 800,000 years, but it has been around as a physical space in which human beings lived and worked and created a culture of their own. So,
I'd like to add my thanks for the invitation to speak here tonight. I'm very pleased to have done that, to have received it, and to be able to talk to you tonight. The first chapter we wrote in this book is The Land and Its Early Inhabitants. I have a nice satellite view which illustrates some of the things that Carla was talking about of the strategic location of the Iberian Peninsula, connecting the Mediterranean world with the wider Atlantic world, connecting Europe with Latin America and the other parts of the Americas, connecting Europe and Africa, and Europe and other parts of the world. The important thing about this is that Spain has, of course, been a crossroads for all of those years. The people of you can see a closer image here of just how close Spain is to Africa. One of the first things we needed to talk about, really, though, was how the land itself was organized and how it is laid out. The environment, the climatology, the geography, and the geology of Spain. And as Carla mentioned, Spain has almost everything in terms of variations of land types that the United States has in a much smaller area. It goes from the Spanish Pyrenees in the north, which is a very mountainous region, goes south and into the central portion of Spain, where there's another mountainous region, the Sierra de Guadarrama, and this is north of Madrid. Before you even get there, you get the high tablelands of the northern meseta. This is called the Tierra de Campos, which is a very rich agricultural land, particularly for wheat production. South of the Sierra de Guadarrama, you get the lands of Estremadura and La Mancha. Estremadura, a land of herding for the most part. La Mancha, wine growing up here in the top. They're harvesting wine grapes at this point. And here they're harvesting the stamen of the autumn crocus, which is where, which is saffron. And this is where the saffron comes from in Spain. So they are harvesting that. This is the area of Don Quixote later on, and the windmills, because there are very few rivers in this part of Spain and they need to grind the grain that's being produced there, so they use windmills to do it. If we go farther south, there is a part of Spain in the southeast that is a true desert. It's the desert of Elche, and here you can see the date palms and that are being grown on very sandy soil that receives very little rainfall over the course of a year. Andalusia in the south, mainly the valley of the Guadalquivir River. Here it is in its passage through Cordoba. We'll talk about Cordoba a little bit later as well. And here it is in its passage through Seville, on its way to the Atlantic. Andalusia is one of the places in Spain where olive trees grow in enormous numbers and cover hillsides from miles afar, miles and miles and miles. And if you look at the next bottle of olive oil that you buy, it may have an Italian label on it, but if you look carefully, you'll see that perhaps some of that olive oil came from Spain, because the Italians import vast amounts of olive oil from Spain, bottle it, and send it back to us to be sold in the supermarkets. But the land is rich in part, but it's also difficult in part. And the fact that there are so many mountains in Spain has made it difficult for movement from place to place. Even in the 21st century, it's difficult to get from place to place in Spain. So that's a constraint on the development of Spain over the millennia. And when you finally get down to the bottom of the Iberian Peninsula, you can look across 10 miles of the Strait of Gibraltar and see Morocco. So it is well connected in various parts, and it has a enormous variety of landforms. It also has a variety of people living there. This is the railroad cut in a little valley called Atapuerca, which is close to Burgos in the north central portion of Spain. The British mining company cut this particular path to run a railroad for mining operations at the turn of the 20th century in the early 1900s. It became vacant because the mine, whatever they were mining, ran out, and so it was just sitting there. And archaeologists from various universities nearby started taking their archaeological students into that cut and started excavating material there and ended up finding some of the earliest Europeans, or in fact the earliest Europeans, 800,000 years ago, the people of Atapuerca. And here are a set of modern renderings of what they must have looked like at the time, but these are the first Europeans, and they lived close around Atapuerca. Later on, there were early other prehistoric people living in Spain. This is the High Paleolithic, and the cave paintings of Altamira in the north of Spain are some of the most beautiful and representative of cave paintings to be found any place in the world. This is a bison. Here are some others, a deer, and here you can see the people looking up at the cave paintings that were done on the ceilings of the caves. Interesting thing about these paintings is that they were not decorations for where people lived in the cave. These were way back in the recesses of the cave and no doubt had some sort of religious, they were used in some sort of religious rituals. We're not sure why. And for this chapter, writing about the landforms and writing about the early people, we had to rely on the work of geologists, archaeologists, anthropologists in areas that we had not done original work in ourselves. But we read about those, trusted them, and in the course of our historical research, we have traveled to most parts of the Iberian Peninsula and have seen all of those landforms. So that's one of the ways that we worked to produce the first chapter of this book. In the second chapter, we talked about ancient legacies, the people of ancient civilizations who lived in the Iberian Peninsula. The Romans, of course, are the most important of these figures, and we'll talk about those. But before the Romans came along, there were others. There were indigenous civilizations. This is the Dama de Elche, and this is a sculpture of the Iberians. By the time the other Mediterranean people came to the Iberian Peninsula, there were Iberians and Celts living in the peninsula. The Iberians lived along the Mediterranean coast of Spain, and this is one of the high points of their art, discovered in the late 19th century. In fact, it is so good that when it was discovered, it took a long time for art historians and archaeologists to accept it as real. They thought at first that it was too good to have been produced by ancient people. But this is the Dama de Elche, and it's become a symbol of that region of Spain, that town in Spain. In fact, today, she has been used on Spanish banknotes up here at the top. This is quite an old one. In various depictions here. Here's an old postage stamp. And each year there is a young woman elected as the Dama de Elche of the year. And here's one a few years ago, here's a more recent one, and she dresses up in the same sort of costume that the Dama de Elche would have worn. Now, we don't know a lot about the Iberians except from archaeology, because they had a written language that scholars have still not deciphered, because they don't have any examples except for inscriptions on stone and inscriptions on coins. And here is an inscription on a coin in the Iberian alphabet. I mean, it's an alphabet based on probably Phoenician types, but unlike others, and no one to this point has deciphered it. The real written history of the Iberian Peninsula begins with the advent of Mediterranean colonizations of the Iberian Peninsula. The first were the people of Phoenicia. Phoenicia is this strip of the eastern Mediterranean with a number of cities along here. Tyre was at that point the most important of the Phoenician cities. And the Phoenicians traded widely through the Mediterranean all the way through to the Strait of Gibraltar. And they established colonies all along the North African coast and all along the southern coast of Spain, including and also in the Balearic Islands and here in the Italian islands. But in addition to that, the Greeks, depicted here in blue, left Greece and established colonies throughout southern Italy, in the islands, in areas of what's today southern France, and along the eastern coast of Spain. They intermingled with the Iberians. They exchanged ideas as well as peoples, and brought Eastern Mediterranean civilization to the peninsula. The city of Cadiz in the south of Spain was a Phoenician establishment, and it goes back at least 2,500 years. Some people say 3,000, but that's an exaggeration. But it is, by all accounts, the longest inhabited, continually inhabited city in Western Europe. But it's really with the Romans that the integration of the Iberian Peninsula into the rest of the Mediterranean world gets underway. I'm going to have a drink. we were talking so animatedly at the reception, we didn't get a chance to have a drink or even a bite to eat, so bear with me. The Romans came in, and you can see in this shot of the walls of Tarragona in eastern Spain, the layers of various conquerors, and well, it starts with indigenous walls here at the bottom. The stones down here were the first walls of the city. The Romans came along, they added these up to here. People in the Middle Ages repaired the walls, and in the Middle Ages they built towers. So you can see strata of human occupation over a long period here. The Romans built roads and bridges and aqueducts, built cities throughout the Iberian Peninsula, some of which are still preserved, so many of the features are still preserved in them. This is the most elaborate still remaining aqueduct in Spain. This is in Segovia, northern Spain. And for scale, these are people down here at the bottom. But this carried water from a nearby reservoir into the high part of the city of Segovia into the 20th century. That's how well the Romans built their aqueducts. They built bridges. Here's one in Cordoba in the south. Here is one in Merida in the west. And this is the Roman bridge across the river, which was used as a highway bridge until, I think, 1997 or 1999, when this new bridge was built in the background. That's how well Roman construction held up over the years. And if you go to Barcelona, you can find an underground museum which shows the street plan of Roman Barcelona and the foundations of houses and shops throughout the region there. So the Romans were very important. The Romans brought their language, Latin language. Most of the languages of the Iberian Peninsula derive from Latin. There are other languages, of course. The Basque language is a pre-Roman language. There was the Hebrew language during the late Roman times in the Middle Ages with the Jewish communities. And of course, when the Arabs came in, they brought Arabic as a language over the course of the Middle Ages. But the Latin language has been and derivatives of the Latin language have been the standard languages and the most spoken languages in the Iberian Peninsula since Roman times. The Romans, however, as everybody knows, suffered a decline in the western portion of their empire, and they were replaced by the Visigoths. We don't know very much about Visigoths. They followed Roman rules for the most part in language, law, and religion. Their art is very beautiful, but relatively limited in the kinds of variety of things they produced. Here is a series of votive crowns. Every time a king was crowned, he would commission a crown to be constructed and hung in the church in which he was crowned. One of the most famous of these is the crown of Recaswinth in the Archaeological Museum in Madrid today. By the time of the 8th century onward, with the advent of Islam in the Iberian Peninsula, things changed considerably. The religion of Islam began in Arabia. This map shows that by the time of the death of Muhammad in 632, the Muslims were in control of all of the Arabian Peninsula. And within 150 years after his death, they had expanded from the Indus Valley all the way through the Middle East, up here into Central Asia, across all of North Africa, and into Spain, and partially into southern France, or what became southern France later on. In this, there was a great deal of exchange of ideas, exchange of peoples. The Muslims who came into the Iberian Peninsula were not all Arab. They had recruited other people along the way. Syrians were an important element within that. But particularly, they recruited a number of people from North Africa, Northwest Africa, the Berbers. So the invaders of Spain were led by an officer corps, mainly of Arabs with a few Syrians, but with the troops, mainly Berbers, recent converts to Islam, who came into the Iberian Peninsula in the early 8th century and took over almost all of it, except for this area up in the north. Over the course of the centuries of Muslim Spain, Spain, Islamic Spain, Al-Andalus, as it was called, occupied a very important place within the Islamic world. It became an independent, first emirate, and then an independent caliphate. This is emblematic of the breakup of political unity of the Muslim world in this period. But it was an important thing for exchange of ideas and exchange of peoples, because in this whole region, Arabic, the Arabic language, and the Quran as a religious source, but also as a political and even a commercial source for law, was important in facilitating trade throughout the Mediterranean world. Now, over the course of this period, Christians and Jews living within Islamic Spain occupied a particular position. They were considered dhimmi, or people of the book. They were considered to have be, they were considered to be trying to worship God in the ways they knew, but not the Islamic way of worshiping God. And so they could live their lives under the leadership of their religious leaders, but they could not occupy certain positions that would give them authority over Muslims. So it was a part of convivencia, living together, but they were living in not the same level of civil rights and political rights that the Muslims had. Over the course of this period, there was a reconquest. And we will talk about that in the next. Oh, actually, before I do that, I forgot to show you the slides of some of the great monuments of Islamic art in Spain. This is the Mosque of Cordoba. You see the minaret where the muezzin would call prayers at the proper times during the day. This is the courtyard of the orange trees outside where people would come in and prepare to go into the mosque itself to do their praying. This is what the interior looks like. You see it's absolutely beautiful and elaborate with all kinds of incised stonework, with ceramic works and carvings of statuary and so on. You'll see this along here. This is the mihrab, which is the most holy part of any mosque. It's where the mosque's copy of the Quran is held, and it has a beautiful gold work on the inside and beautiful tile and incised work with quotations from the Quran surrounding the entrance. Here is the Cathedral of Seville, and you can see it was a mosque itself before the Christian reconquest. Here is the minaret. It's now a bell tower. They added this part here and the top of it. And this is the courtyard outside. It's a cloister now. And it, where the mosque was, the Christians built what turned out to be one of the largest Gothic cathedrals in the world after the reconquest. Over the course of the late Middle Ages, Spain became one of the most important powers in the of the Western European world. These are the particular parts of the Iberian Peninsula in the 15th and 16th century. Castile and Aragon got together in 1469 with the marriage of Fernando and Isabel, and finally the conquest of Granada in 1492 and the absorption of Navarre in 1512 gave the Iberian Peninsula, or gave Spain, its modern outlines, but we'll get to that in a few minutes. One of the most important things that happened during this period, was the development of an important economy in Spain based upon merino sheep moved from place to place over the cañadas, or the sheep paths of Spain. You could still see these at work today. And from this, Spain had an enormous amount of export income. They also used the wool from those sheep. Merino wool is some of the finest wool in the world. And it was invented and developed there. They developed a textile industry, and Spain developed very quickly and highly as a commercial entity in the course of those late Middle Ages. Fernando and Isabel, as I say, put together Spain at the end of the 15th century. Here is her father, Juan II of Castile. Here's Enrique IV of Castile. Here's her Fernando's father, Juan II of Aragon. And here the two of them are. They are, they put Spain together. It was not a consolidation, a complete consolidation. It was sort of like a merger of two countries, but they remained independent. And politically, in terms of legal systems, in terms of fiscal systems, and in terms of various other things, they were not really put together until much later. But here's the pictures of Fernando and Isabel. In the course of various centuries, they have got better looking in the representations. Here's a 19th century representation. Here's some representations and postage stamps of the 20th century. By the 21st century, here's what they look like. These are the actors who played Fernando and Isabel in the very recent ongoing Spanish television series. But they sort of reflect what they looked like at this time. But in the course of their putting the two kingdoms together and working together, they did what all good monarchs did in the late Middle Ages, and that was arrange marriage alliances for their children with countries around Western Europe, which would be useful for Spain's foreign policy and position in the world. And that's what Carla Phillips will pick up with.
What Wim didn't say is that when we get into the Middle Ages, we're getting into the area in which Wim has done his major research. So you get a little surer touch when you're reading other people's work because you know the field better, and it gives you confidence in trusting or not trusting the work of other scholars. What Ferdinand and Isabel did, as he said, was to form marriage alliances that would be useful for their joint monarchy. They weren't aiming at a European empire, and I think that's very important to emphasize. The empire that developed was an accident. They had arranged marriages with Portugal, with France, with, in particular, with the Habsburg family of Central Europe, because all of those countries, and I misspoke, not with France, because France was forming up as a major enemy of the combined monarchy of Aragon and Castile, but they form marriage alliances with the areas that would work with them to combat any pressure from France to become the dominant power in Europe. So they were lucky to have five children who lived to adulthood out of 10 live births and I don't know how many miscarriages that Isabel suffered, but five children who lived to adulthood out of 10 births was a very good record in these centuries. So these five became pawns of marriages arranged by their parents. The Habsburg marriages ended up being the most important. Here's Maximilian of Habsburg, elected Holy Roman Emperor, and his wife, Mary of Burgundy, who brought essentially the Low Countries that we know today into the marriage, into the Habsburg family. Their son, Philip, married a daughter of Ferdinand and Isabel. And their oldest son married a daughter of this pair. That second marriage Didn't work out because the Spanish prince died. Wife had a stillborn child. These things happen. But the marriage between the princess, Spanish princess, and Philip of Habsburg produced eventually 6 children who lived to adulthood. An extraordinary record. And among them was Charles, his brother Ferdinand, and numerous others who in their own turn became marriage partners to cement alliances. The luck of the draw, Charles was raised in the Netherlands, Ferdinand was raised in Spain. When they began to grow up, Ferdinand was sent to the Germanies to take up the Habsburg inheritance. Charles was sent to Spain to become King of Spain. But at the point at which he was 4 years old, this one here, it was already known that he would inherit a vast responsibility. It hadn't been planned, but there were deaths of all the other marriages that took out of the running the heirs who would have succeeded to one place or another. Dynastic principle was hard enough won over the course of 15th century wars that you didn't mess with it. So he inherited Castile, Aragon, the Kingdom of the Two Sicilies that was part of Ferdinand of Aragon's inheritance. He inherited the Netherlands. He inherited the Habsburg lands here. And the putative right to be elected Holy Roman Emperor in his grandfather's footsteps, and that's what happened. So he was Charles I of Spain, elected at the age of 19, Charles V of the Holy Roman Empire, with all the enormous responsibilities that that entailed. 2 years after he was elected Holy Roman Emperor, in 1521, Martin Luther challenged certain aspects of the universal Christian church at that point, and the resultant Protestant Reformation, as we call it, essentially shattered Christian unity in Europe. And here was Charles, at the age of 21, flap in the middle of all this, defending the Catholic Church against the splits that occurred during his lifetime. So he had all of that responsibility and sponsored overseas expeditions. And this part was planned, but his role in Europe was accidental. He took it on. It killed him at an early age, but he couldn't avoid it. But this part he wanted. So he sponsored expeditions overseas. The Aztec Empire was conquered by Hernan Cortes in the name of Charles. The Inca Empire was conquered by Francisco Pizarro and his cohort or band of thugs, depending on how you want to view them, in the name of Charles. And that was the beginning of Spain's empire in the Americas. But what they were aiming at, ultimately, was what Columbus had tried to find a generation before, and that was a route to Asia. The lands in the Americas were a surprise to Columbus. He died thinking he was on the fringes of Asia. By Charles's reign, it was pretty clear that this was something else, and it became absolutely clear when Charles, in one of his earliest acts as King of Spain, sponsored the voyage of Ferdinand Magellan, a Portuguese working for Charles, working for Spain. And Magellan's voyage through the strait that bears his name, and then he was killed in the Philippines, and the voyage eventually came back to Spain. But that did prove that, no, what Columbus had found was not Asia, it was something else. Asia was over here a long way farther on. So with Magellan's voyage, Spain had circumnavigated the whole globe and was trying to figure out what to do with those lands, all claimed in the name of the King of Spain, Charles. So the Habsburg dynasty that Charles, he doesn't found it in Spain, his father, Philip, is the first Habsburg King of Spain. The Habsburg dynasty ruled in Spain for 200 years, basically from 1500 to 1700. And then kind of in descending order, we get the minor Habsburgs in the 17th century. Philip III, Philip IV, this is Velázquez's king, and Velázquez painted everybody in the family brilliantly, and Charles II, the product of generations of Habsburg inbreeding, and it all came to roost in the unfortunate Charles II. But even he, in the late 17th century, reigned from 1665 to 1700. The rest of Europe was expecting him to die momentarily for decades, but he kept on. And the fascinating thing to me about his reign and about all of the reigns of the minor Habsburgs as well as the major is that important things went on during their reigns. And if we only look at the kings and say, well, this is major, major, minor, 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 we miss that there was major naval reform under Philip III in the early 17th century. The peak of Spanish artistic and literary flowering in the mid-17th century under Philip IV. And though there was economic depression for a good part of the 17th century, under the reign of the unfortunate Charles II, right at the tail end of the 17th century, those of us who study economic history, and that's how I started out, found that things were turning up again by about 1680. And if you only look at the poor degenerate monarch, you miss that. You also miss some very competent ministers who worked for those monarchs. But the unfortunate Charles died without an heir, and the Bourbons took over because despite the earlier rivalry with France, the royal houses of France and Spain were intermarried for the whole of the Habsburg period. So when Charles II died without an heir, the likely candidate, dynastic principle being followed, the likely candidate was a grandson of Louis XIV of France, Philip, who became Philip V, the first Bourbon king of Spain. Louis XIV of France, because of that intermarriage, was himself a grandson of Philip II of Spain. So the two houses of Bourbon and Habsburg had been intermarried for generations. So the Bourbons of the 18th century also had pretty good luck in having long reigns, very important. This was something that would plague France in the 17th century when a king would die before his children were old enough to succeed properly. Philip V reigned from 1700. He came to the throne when he was about 14 years old. He reigned until 1746. He tried to quit for a while in favor of his son, Luis, but Luis died within a year, and Philip came back to the throne. So he's the king who reigned twice. He also has the distinction of not only reigning twice, but having fathered three subsequent kings of Spain, Luis, and then Ferdinand VI, and Charles III, probably the best king that Spain or anybody ever had. He has a goofy look on his face. He was not handsome, but he was a wonderful, wonderful king in the Enlightenment tradition of the 18th century. And then the last Bourbon of the 18th century, Charles IV. This is Goya's king. Goya was a much better painter than Charles IV was a king, unfortunately. But during the 18th century, when Spain was was no longer the dominant European power. It had been replaced by France, and then France and Britain were in a serious rivalry by the end of the 18th century. At that same time, Spain's colonies in the Americas reached their greatest extent. So they reached their greatest extent when Spain is no longer the dominant power in Europe, but still has a massive overseas empire. This is kind of the wishful thinking empire. Everything blue is part of the Spanish Empire. This is Portuguese Brazil. But everything blue was what Spain claimed in the Americas. The actual extent of both Iberian powers in the America, in the Americas in the 18th century was somewhat more restricted. It's red here for Spanish possessions, and these are the areas that they actually held. They had cities, they were pretty much in control. This is Portuguese Brazil, still concentrated along the coasts, and a lot of the interior areas were simply not effectively colonized by Portugal in Brazil or by Spain in parts of the Americas. But then the major rivalries between France and Britain in various parts of the world in the late 18th century are what we usually concentrate on when we look at the 18th century. At the end of that period, the end of the 18th century, France exploded in the French Revolution, as you know, from 1789 on. And as a part of that, all of Europe is disrupted. All of the old monarchies are pretty much blown out of the water one way or another. And during the Napoleonic Wars, Napoleon sent forces south to Spain, and he managed to dupe Charles IV of Spain, his wife, and his son into coming to France, bamboozled them out of the crown, and gave the throne of Spain to his own brother, Joseph Bonaparte, whom you see here. Joseph was not a bad man. He was not a bad king. He would have been great, except that he was an imposition. He was imposed by an outside force. Spaniards don't like that. Hardly anybody really likes it, but Spaniards really don't. And they rejected him at court. They rejected him as a leader. Cartoons made fun of his fondness for drink. Cartoons made fun of how the people of Spain treated him. And he found himself isolated within the country. You can joke about this Napoleonic period, but the war that erupted to drive the French from Spain, the War of Independence, was anything but humorous. You see here Goya's brilliant portrait, brilliant painting of the charge of Mamluk soldiers in the heart of Madrid on May 2nd, 1808. The execution the next day of Spanish partisans, again in the heart of Madrid, two of the most famous paintings that Goya ever painted. And in the countryside, the absolute horror and brutality of that war. And you see here the French soldiers slicing up a partisan, a Spanish peasant getting his own back with a hatchet. It was one of the most brutally fought wars that was documented by the primary artist of the time, Francisco Goya. When the dust cleared, or as this struggle was going on, down in Cadiz, this ancient city, the Cortes of Cadiz was writing one of the first constitutions in Europe that gave rights to the American colonists. It gave rights to Spaniards that they'd never had before, all in the name of the captive Ferdinand, this prince whom Napoleon had duped out of his throne and who was living in southern France at the time. The Cortes of Cadiz and the Spanish peasants who were fighting desperately to kick the French out wanted Ferdinand back. But it's proof of the old adage, be careful what you wish for, because they got him. Joseph was driven out, Napoleon was defeated, Ferdinand VII came back in to rule in Spain, and never understood what the changes had meant. He was not a good king. And under his watch, though not because he was not a good king, it probably would have happened anyway, but under his watch, Spain lost virtually all of their American colonies. His daughter, who reigned from 1833 to 1868, and unfortunately came in the era in which photography began, so we have her official portrait, and then we have her photograph. There are worse ones. She is shown here with her husband, their son, or her son. She had a scandalous private life. I won't go into it. You can ask. But a scandalous private life because her husband was undoubtedly homosexual. They were first cousins. She knew him from childhood. They knew one another pretty well. The marriage was supposed to be fruitless. It was supposed to not have children. She had other ideas. That's why she had a scandalous personal life. But he acknowledged all of these children as his own. They lasted until 1868. But there was enough turmoil that she was driven out as queen, replaced by another imposition. Amadeo of Savoy lasted a couple of years. And again, a good man. I did a paper on him once. Good king, but he was imposed from the outside. And he really had no chance to develop loyalty. A republic replaced that, the First Republic, and that failed. And the boy grown up came back as Alfonso the 12th and was a good king, but unfortunately died young. His second wife was left as a widow with the child Alfonso the 13th, who was king of Spain from the time he was a baby. Grew up in the public eye, the bourgeoisie, the upper classes of Spanish society in the late 19th century and early 20th century were doing well, but at the same time, the workers were not, and the typical ferment of early industrialization in Spain produced a Socialist Workers' Party, an anarchist trade union, CNT, a socialist trade union as well, and a lot of anarchist activity by direct action. So there was an anarchist bombing at Alfonso the 13th's wedding in 1902, and a very constant undercurrent of turmoil. Spain stayed out of World War I and did well. But the aftermath of World War I, the continuing social ferment and economic ferment, led the king to accede to a military coup in 1923 and to basically form a partnership with a military dictator, Miguel Primo de Rivera. The economy did fairly well. Spanish Paradores, the government hotel chain, was founded under Primo. He was on the cover of Time magazine one year. Alfonso the 13th was on the cover of Time magazine in 1928. But in the course of this dictatorship, the political party structure, a democratic constitutional monarchy party structure, was essentially destroyed because Primo did not believe in political parties. So when Primo himself failed, there was really very little to step in to its place. And in municipal elections of 1931, it was clear that anyone favoring the continuation of the monarchy had been voted out of power. They were only municipal elections, but the king fled. And you see him in exile here. The personification of the Second Republic, and the celebrations in Madrid for that Second Republic, and various political discussions about how to set it up, because it came as a surprise when the king simply fled. But the trouble with that was that the struggle for the Spanish soul was still going on. And the Republic, though it lasted in power from 1931 to 1936, lurched back and forth in a series of governments that never really established the kind of stable society that a lot of Spaniards wanted. And violence in the street by the summer of 1936 was just about unstoppable. And into that gap stepped the military once again. You see Francisco Franco in Africa in the 1920s when he was an up-and-coming officer. By 1936, when the Civil War broke out, he reluctantly joined at the first, and then he was able to take power altogether. By then, he was the youngest general in Europe since Napoleon. And we think of him as the aging dictator of decades later. But when he came to power, he had demonstrated his chops as a military man. There's no question about that. And the Civil War that broke out in the summer of 36 and lasted for 3 years, in which the Republic is still technically the government of Spain, the victory of the military rebels is not inevitable, but it never backs up. It is inexorable, if not inevitable. You see August of September 1936, the blue forces, the nationalist forces making gains. By October of 37, enormous gains. They push through to the sea, then they take Catalonia, and by March of 1939, all that remains is a cleanup operation. During the war, the Republicans appealed to followers for social justice, but they also appealed largely from a left-wing stance. And this is the dilemma that we faced writing about this. The left started out arguing that the only way that Spain could go forward is by eliminating the influence of the church, of capitalism, and of all the traditional forces that had been so important in Spain for so many millennia. Women's rights were very important to the Second Republic, and that was a wonderful, fresh approach for many women. The anarchists were fighting for workers and peasants. But that left a whole lot of Spain out. And the people who still were Christian and supported conservative politics eventually had nothing to hang on to with the Republican cause. And as they gained power, as the forces of the military rebellion gained power, the nationalist appeals were a little smarter in public relations. Unity is what's important here. Social services are important. Women of the Falange handing out bread when the nationalists would achieve power in an area. Looking forward to the future, united without distinction of class. So here is a peasant woman and a middle-aged or middle-class woman united together for the country. So the PR victory, the left certainly had the best posters, but the PR victory was for the nationalists, appealing to unity as opposed to fomenting class divisions. And Franco stayed in power for over 40 years. There is a reason for that. The Republican exiles, who could not bear or knew they would be punished if they stayed went into exile. In France at first, a lot of them in Mexico, and they stayed until the end of the Franco regime, most of them. And the regime was very isolated from the Western democracies. And because of that, and because of natural affinity, Franco allied with Hitler and allied with Mussolini during World War II. Only sent troops to Russia, but allied with the Axis powers. And after the war, because of that, the United Nations said Spain can't even apply. Forget that. So Spain was isolated there, and in the 1940s continued to be isolated after the war, because Franco and Salazar in Portugal were the dictators that lasted. They shouldn't have. Everybody else had been defeated. They shouldn't have been there, and the West resented that. So Spain was isolated and hungry. Argentina sent beef. Spain decided it had to go alone in the economy, set up auto manufacturing and train manufacturing and airplane manufacturing because they were isolated economically. Gradual inclusion in the 1950s, even though Spain was not part of the Marshall Plan, they made a comedy. Bienvenido, Señor Marshall, as if any day they would be part of the Marshall Plan. Of course, they weren't. Ava Gardner and Frank Sinatra kind of indicated that tourism was going to become important, and it became very important. And the final blow to the leftists who remained in Spain was when Eisenhower visited Madrid in 1959, because Franco was a lot of things, but he was always anti-communist. And so that became the thawing with relations with the United States. But that was viewed as just a horrible betrayal by people on the Spanish left. Middle class prosperity in the 60s, turmoil and change in the 70s, when the old Franco finally in 69 designated Juan Carlos as his successor. But the Basque separatist movement blew up Franco's political successor. And by the time that he finally died in 1975, it was not clear what was going to happen. What became clear immediately is that Juan Carlos was going to make Spain democratic in partnership with Adolfo Suarez and other like-minded people who knew that things had to change. Communist veterans of the Civil War who lived in the Soviet Union for decades, Pasionario, Santiago Carrillo, came back to Spain. There's a wonderful picture of Pasionario with King Juan Carlos, which is about as stunning as Eisenhower and Franco. Communist, socialist, everybody was legalized and voted in a democratic government in 1977. And Juan Carlos earned his kibble, as we dog owners say, in February of 1981, when there was an attempted rightist coup. They shot up the parliament. Adolfo Suarez tried to argue them down, didn't work. Juan Carlos called every military man that he knew, and he knew them all, got their loyalty, went on television after midnight and said, that's it, coup is over. But everybody knew, and he knew, and he told the politicians, okay, I can do that once. The next time, they'll kill me first. So it's up to you to make the government work. In the 80s, Spain voted for a socialist government that stayed in power for 12 years, and that was really the maturing of the democracy. If they can vote for a socialist government, keep it in power, King was fine with that. Here's King with Felipe González. And all the old veterans from both sides of the Civil War, I won't name them, sat together for a group portrait. That it's stunning when you know the history of each one of these people. And in the 90s, Expo in Seville in 92, Olympics in Barcelona in 92, and a succession of political leaders. PSOE on the left, Popular Party on the right, PSOE on the left, Popular Party on the right, a turno, an alternation in power that we're used to seeing in Western democracies, but Spain hadn't seen much. And the same sense of Spanish politicians and the king and queen, that they were a bridge with Latin America and also with the world of Islam. They had been interacting with them for 800 years, not always happily, but certainly interacting. And so Spain saw itself very much as a bridge.
Many of you, or some of you at least in this room, have read the first edition of our Concise History of Spain. We found in the last several years that we really needed to write a second edition and do a second edition. Not so much for what we had said in the first 7.5 chapters, but for what we had said in the last half chapter of the book. And I'll explain exactly what happened. We wrote the book starting in 2003 when Spain was experiencing an economic boom. By the time we finished writing the book and turned it in, it was 2009. And Spain was in a serious economic crisis, as were many countries in Western Europe, and as was the United States, if you remember. It was for Spain, it was a crisis that almost exactly mirrored what went on in the United States. There was a construction boom that was financed on credit. There was a credit crisis, a credit crunch, and people who had borrowed money to build apartment buildings and build office buildings or to buy houses or apartments in Spain found that they could no longer keep up with the payments for that. The construction boom stopped. People were laid off. Unemployment rose tremendously. And banks and savings and loans, right and left, were failing or forced to merge with others. Spain, the cost of borrowing money by the Spanish government rose to great heights, and the crisis was a severe one. European Union and various European central banks and so on worked to help out that, but it was a severe crisis that hit its bottom in 2009. It continued still below what should be the general level, continued over the course. And in 2013, it started moving upward. It's moved upward in 2014 and 2015. It's still on that upward path. But in this period, I have to go back. In this long period, a lot of things happened in Spain that we were not prepared for when we wrote this last chapter, and so we had to pick it up. Socially, there was discontent as all of this happened. I mentioned unemployment. Unemployment was high, enormously high in Spain. It was especially acute among young, well-educated people who had graduated from universities and could not find jobs. It was an extremely demoralizing sort of situation. In 2011, the present government, a center-right government in Spain, the PP party, replaced the Socialist Party, and the last socialist leader of the party had not really addressed the situation in Spain as quickly and as thoroughly as he should have. So after the center-right party replaced the socialist, the center-right Prime Minister Rajoy had to institute austerity measures, which still exacerbated the problem to a certain degree, but helped it in the long run to move forward. But this didn't really, it was a public relations failure on his part. And it took a long time for the momentum to turn and move forward. In the meantime, leftist, beyond the left, left beyond the Socialist Party began to stage demonstrations. They staged an occupation of the Puerta del Sol, which is the principal, one of the principal main squares in Madrid, that lasted for months. In Catalonia, the leader of the Catalonian regional government started a campaign for Catalan independence that's still going on today, but with much less steam as because of a lot of scandals in Catalonia. And there were calls for abolition of the monarchy and the creation of a new republic. So we wrote all this before this developed, when Spain was still enjoying the boom, and when the king of Spain, Juan Carlos, still had high public opinion ratings. He would be frequently rated as the number one king in the history of Spain, vying only with Charles III of the 18th century. But all that began to collapse. People looked at the monarchy and said, this is something, or people of the left looked at the monarchy and said, this is something we can no longer afford. We can't afford this. And members of the royal family began to experience a fall off in popular approval. The queen herself, Queen Sophia, and the heir apparent, Prince Felipe, still were regarded highly. But the two daughters lost in public opinion. The elder daughter, Elena, and her husband divorced, and she retired away from the public appearances that she'd been well known for beforehand. The second daughter, Christina, had married an Olympic handball player who became involved in a long festering and still unresolved set of legal cases about financial shenanigans. And this is still going on, and this caused problems for the crown. Worst of all, the king himself was involved in a scandal. He came a cropper in 2012. He went on a hunting expedition to Botswana to shoot elephants. Now, there are a lot of problems with this. Problem was, first of all, when the king of Spain leaves the country, he is supposed to notify the prime minister, the head of the government. Juan Carlos, unfortunately for himself, in Botswana, fell and broke his hip and had to be airlifted back to Spain. When that happened, all kinds of problems started developing in the as a consequence of this. The problem, aside from his terrible hip operation that he had to have, it was revealed that he had not notified the government. It was regarded by many people in Spain, not just of the left, that this was a terrible thing to do in the middle of an economic crisis, to go off to Botswana. It's a very expensive thing to do. There was a headline that said it cost 30,000 euros to go hunting in Botswana, and here the king is doing that. It turns out that, he was already, had been for many years, the honorary chairman of the World Wildlife Fund. And it doesn't work, it doesn't look very nice for the chairman of the World Wildlife Fund to go off shooting elephants anywhere. And it turns out that there had been a German princess on the expedition who was widely suspected of having been a lover of the king. All of this came to a head after the Botswana expedition. So for the next 2 years, Juan Carlos was unable to turn the tide of public opinion. He was unable for a long time to even get well from the operation. The first hip implant became infected. He had to have a second operation. He was laid up in bed for 6 weeks without moving. And as a result of that, with all the hostility that was growing in the press and with the movement away from the king in various leftist circles, he decided in the summer, last summer, June of last summer, that he would abdicate. This took a lot of people by surprise. Here's the abdication. Here's some of the press in Spain that talked about the abdication. And his son, Prince Felipe, was to be the new king. And we didn't talk much about Prince Felipe. We didn't we didn't know about the decline of the king's popularity when we wrote the book, but we decided we had to really do something about this, and Cambridge University Press agreed with us. And so we will have more about Felipe in this. Here he is as a young child. He got better looking pretty quickly. Here he is as, with his family when he was about probably 5 or 6 years old. Here he is in 1987 when he's about 19 with the rest of the royal family and with Prince Charles, Princess Di. And here is Prince Philip, and here is Prince Harry, who have grown up to fame and fortune these days. Prince Felipe, just like his father, had gone through all the Spanish military academies. He's well-connected in Spain. He's a person who has no scandal touching him. And here he was in 1996, the Spain's flag bearer in the Atlanta Olympics of 1996. He was a member of the Spanish sailing team at that point, Olympic sailing team. Same year, he received a master's degree in international relations at Georgetown University. And here he is, here's a worker cleaning off the sign that's showing the preparations for the coronation or the proclamation of Felipe as the King of Spain on the 19th of June of 2014. And here he is agreeing to speaking in the Congress, talking about his acceptance of the situation. And here he is addressing the people from a balcony at the Royal Palace in Madrid right after this proclamation was done. He has enormous preparation for being king. As I say, he is still regarded very highly by most Spaniards. And the problem is that there are other Spaniards who think that a republic should come up. And I'm sure in his thoughts it's difficult for him because he must think back on his family background. His great-grandfather, Alfonso XIII, had to leave Spain in 1931. His grandfather, Juan, the father of Juan Carlos, never was able to live in Spain for his entire life. He lived in exile all that time. And Juan Carlos, his father, chose to abdicate in the summer of 2014. On his mother's side, his grandfather was the king of Greece, King Paul, who was forced into exile for a number of years. He had to live outside of Greece in the Second World War because the Germans had taken it over. And the Queen of Spain's brother, King Constantine, was kicked out as King of Greece by a military coup. So young 46-year-old Felipe VI has a difficult task ahead of him, but I hope he is up to it because he seems like a nice person. And here he is looking at his wife and daughters in the course of that proclamation. So that's how we've been able to cover 8,000 years of Spanish history in a little bit longer than we anticipated, but you've stuck with us and we appreciate that.
We'll open it up for some questions now. If you want to stay at the podium, both of you please.
Hi, we were just wondering which lessons that derived from Spain's political history do you think most aptly apply to politics today?
I would say, off the top of my head, don't ever have another civil war. That's one of the things that kept the lid on, I think, in the Franco years. A civil war is terrible. We've had one. But it literally splits families, and you don't heal for a long, long time, if ever. So I think that is a lesson that is still there, and I think even the younger generation that never experienced it, never experienced the privation and everything that came along with that. I think they are also aware that that's one of the worst things. So the value of compromise, I think, is very important. What would you say?
No, I agree with that. And the fact that Franco stayed in power for so long after the Civil War meant that the wounds of the Civil War really couldn't be healed until after he was gone. And it took a generation after that for them to be healed as much as they have been now, but they're still there.
Yeah.
And another question right here.
Looking at the maps that you put up earlier, yeah. I'm just wondering how it is that Spain and Portugal were never combined into one country.
That's a wonderful, wonderful question. The question was, well, okay, all the rest of the Iberian Peninsula became Spain. Why didn't Portugal become Spain? In fact, Fernando de Isabel tried, and the marriages, they married a son and two of their daughters to a Portuguese princess and two princes.
One after another.
Kept dying. And I think that probably was their highest priority with these marriages, but deaths took place and it didn't develop the way they anticipated.
Yeah, and then they were united under the Habsburgs. Philip II, the tail end of the 16th century, claimed the throne when his nephew went off and got himself killed on a crusade in North Africa. And the Portuguese and Castilian houses were so intermarried that Philip really had the best claim to the throne, claimed it. And between 1580 and 1640, there was a Habsburg king, same guy, of both Spain and Portugal. The empires were kept separate, and the capital was in Madrid, but he and two of his successors were kings of Portugal as well as Spain.
But there were several attempts, even in the late Middle Ages, before Fernando and Isabel, efforts to combine the two countries didn't work. They tried as hard as they could, but their children kept dying, or the spouses of their children kept dying. And by the time of Philip II and the Habsburg rulers of Portugal, I think the Portuguese themselves had such a tradition of opposition to Spain that they didn't really want to carry out any kind of amalgamation, and it became impossible after that.
Yeah, it's interestingly enough now with both as members of the economic union, there's a whole lot of economic interchange, and of course any Portuguese trucks that want to go anywhere, guess where they have to drive through? And so there is a lot more interchange now, and we belong to academic groups that are Portuguese and Spanish and academics working on the same kind of issues. So.
Anyone else? We have one right here.
Mine's a very simple question here. In lieu of the Oscars last night, do you ever get asked to justify or talk about or give the historical background for a movie maker or somebody's novel or something like that?
Unfortunately, yes, because they never listen. But
no, we. I was asked some years ago. There's a very famous poem in of the late Middle Ages in Spain. It's called the Libro de Buen Amor, and it was written by a cleric, and it's really about carnal love as well as love of God. And I was invited to WGBH in Boston, and they were going to, PBS was going to put together some kind of series on that. But it never came to fruition. I don't know what happened to it. We tried to give them good advice, and nothing happened from it. But there are other problems. We wrote a book about Columbus back in 1992, and movies that came out about Columbus, we just tore our hair as we were watching them because there were so many errors in them.
Yeah, just hilarious, wrong things. But interestingly enough, the stuff that's done on Spanish television about Spanish history, they get really good advice from Spanish historians. And so this thing with Ferdinand and Isabel, except for the fact that they're a lot better looking than the originals were, I mean, it's good history. It really is good history. But American movie makers don't really care about this. And, you know, if you want to put mountains in the middle of a Caribbean island that's flat as a pancake because the mountains look better, you just do it. But regardless of the historical accuracy.
Well, thank you very much, everyone, for coming tonight. And thank you, William and Carla, for a wonderful lecture.